Hello everyone, Reed Duke here. Welcome to a modern gameplay video here on channelfireball.com. Today I am playing Red Prowess Splashing Green. So this includes the new Questing Druid, which is a really fun card that I've wanted to sort of bring to some video content for a while, ever since I saw it previewed with Wilds of Eldraine. Red Prowess is one of my favorite modern archetypes. It's not one of the necessarily top decks in modern, but it's very powerful, very fast, and it shows up every once in a while in those top tournament finishes. What I really enjoy about the deck is it's very customizable. So this includes your color combinations, your choice of companion. Today I'm using Gigantha, your individual card choices. So a lot of room to take this in the direction that you want. And then it's kind of just a nice deck in terms of being fast, consistent, but also having staying power and giving its pilot a bit of like fun agency over the direction of the game, you know, card selection and navigating those tricky combat steps. So what I'm going to do today is run my Red Prowess deck through a 5-match Modern League. Let me go ahead and join up the league, and then if we have some time, I can go over the deck list while we wait. So Modern League, Red Prowess with green, very good, play match. So regarding individual card choices, the first one I want to mention is Chalice of the Void, which this is the one card in my deck that actually conflicts with Gigantha. So I encourage you to be sort of all or nothing when it comes to Chalice. If you don't consider beating Teemer Rhinos or Living End as one of your top priorities, you could just skip it entirely. But if you do decide to play Chalice, you probably want to have about three in your deck, because just boarding in one copy and losing your companion is not really a great way to do it. Other than that, the main deck is got four of all the key pieces, 16 creatures with the 12 one drops and the four questing druids. And then I have threes, ones, and twos of some other cards like Mishra's Bauble and Mutagenic Growth, which are both really good in the deck. You're happy to draw these, but they don't pump the Questing Druid since they are not red spells, and you know, maybe you don't want to draw them in too many copies, can lead to some awkward draws. Abundant Harvest is a cool one, kind of like Green's version of a Preordain cantrip type effect. But anyway, I think this is going to be a great time. Let's get to it. Okay, so this is a little bit of an awkward opener, in that you definitely don't need to open on five lands with Red Prowess. This is a deck that operates very well on, say, like two lands. But if I was going to have two spells in my hand, these are two of the best that I could have. I also have the companion if I'm super mana flooded. So you can kind of think of this as like a really good five card hand. I mean, with just what I have, you can think about turn one Channeler, end of turn two Seek the Beast, turn three I cast the spells that I found off of Seek the Beast, then turn four I have like Questing Druid or Pull for the Companion. So I'm gonna be able to do things with my mana. It's just not the most explosive hand. So if I could mulligan and guarantee like something similar where I cash in two of these lands for one more spell, I would probably do that. But I think I'm actually just going to keep this because, you know, I don't want to mulligan and have like a zero lander and have to go to five. This, it will be at least interesting to see how this plays out. Let's see how much weight the Questing Druid can carry. It's also pretty matchup dependent, because if this was just a pure racing type of matchup, like a combo deck or Urzatron or something, it would probably be correct to mulligan, but you know, it could wind up being okay against a deck, an opponent who keeps a hand heavy on removal spells, and I can just grind it out with Seek the Beasts. All right, so we have Misty Rainforest for Zagoth Triome. That indicates to me probably some kind of Leyline Binding deck. Or Zoo, maybe. I guess those would be one and the same. Ouch. All right. All I guess I'm okay with Scalding Tarn Pass. I can't use the Swift Spear to actually kill the Renin 6. So I'll try to just make that happen next turn. Fetch my mountain and seek the beast. All right, hit another land and a lava dart. So nothing too exciting. So Swift Spear Harvest Lava Dart is a way that I could approach this turn. Choose non-land. I found Lightning Bolt. Attack the Wren and just pass priority. And if that all checks out, then I go ahead and lava dart it post-combat. And cool. That works for me. So still not totally sure what I'm up against here. Once again, I think it's a five-color deck with Leyline Binding. We see all the Renin 6. They're not doing the Dwarven Mine thing, so it's less likely to be Indomitable Creativity. Could be a Scapeshift deck, a Bring to Light deck, just a value four-color Omnath deck. Up the Beanstalk might make an appearance, but we'll see. It's kind of the cool thing about Modern right now is there's a lot of different directions you can take all the archetypes. The One Ring. All right, so I can't damage my opponent this turn. I'll have to just play my Questing Druid and set up a bit. My opponent did not draw, which indicates a real effort to preserve life total. Here comes Omnath. So I could go like Bolt Lava Dart in response to the trigger, which seems like a fine decision. You know, I wanted to play Seek the Beast, but just making sure the Omnath doesn't give my opponent this influx of life and mana. I feel like from this position, they're going to need to have, you know, one or two removal spells to protect themselves. Like, they really hope to have Solitude here or untapped White Source plus Leyline Binding. And if they don't, I can unload quite a lot of damage next turn. Okay. So am I seeking the beast? Am I doing abundant harvest? Keeping in mind that the harvest does not trigger the questing druid. I suppose I could also start with crash through. I think I want to start with seek the beast. I found Underworld Breach, Dragon's Rage Channeler. So the Breach is actually like not a great hit. That would have been a nice card to draw naturally. But I don't have Mishra's Bauble in my graveyards or Mutagenic Growth, so I can't really make good use of that. So I think I'm going to play the Channeler and the Crash Through, and then I'm going to Crash Through. The Bauble. The Bauble can go to the graveyard. Yeah, let's get in for 9. Now opponents got to play catch up. I mean, they have a lot of cards, they have a lot of mana, but they have to deal with multiple of these threats if they want to stay in the game. So there's Omnath. That's a good way for it to start because Omnath can, of course, rebuy you the life and the mana. They could also choose to pass the turn with the fetch land available to gain 4 more life. So you can see, like, I kept the kind of anemic-looking 5-land hand, but I've really been able to spend my mana every single turn. That's the power of Questing Druid, giving you another threat, but also increasing your, your card advantage, your card selection, your giving you mana sinks. The One Ring has not yet been activated. There we go. So hopefully we're in a world where the Omnath is chump blocking the Questing Druid. I think that's pretty optimistic because my opponent can have Solitude, Leyline Binding, Teferi, Time Raveler, a different blocker, any of the above. Fury. I guess Fury is not even that good on this board. Valky, God of Lies. So you can turn that into a Soul Scar Mage if you like. Hoping my Abundant Harvest can find me a burn spell, like a Lava Dart would be super good here. Okay. So question one is, do I want to fetch with the Scalding Tarn first? I have 1 Stomping Ground as my only remaining fetchable land. Yeah, I think that's fine. Go to 13. Yeah, it's fine. I would like to find a non-land card, please. Yeah, that's totally fine. Just chain the cantrips. So do I want the fiery islet to be in my graveyard or my library? I guess graveyard, because I do have one more underworld reach. Non-land, please. Found Metamorphose, perfect. Okay, but the fun does stop there. You imagine the Valky is going to chump the questing druid, and then my opponent could choose to go to two and then to one from the one ring. I wish I could look down and have another lava dart in my graveyard, but I don't. So, yep, it is what it is. Okay, Solitude. Gotcha. So, opponent goes to six, untaps with the very scary combination of the One Ring and Omnath, and I'm kind of, it's kind of a do your worst type of situation. Remember, no fetchable lands left in my deck, so really hoping I start to find some non-land cards. I mean, what can this be besides Supreme Verdict or Bring to Light for Supreme Verdict, something like that? It could be a new Omnath. That's possible. Yep, Bring to Light makes a bit more sense. Right, Lightning Bolt, that's not nothing. But it seems like we're kind of looking at Giganta versus the One Ring, which is not usually a fight that Giganta is going to win. If I find my other Underworld Breach, I have a stacked graveyard. 5, 6, 7. Sure. Could fire the bolt here, but I'm just gonna wait. Rebuild, rebuild. All right, Soulscar Mage has been counterspelled. So, in theory, another Lightning Bolt could steal a win for me. Firebolt is not a bad draw. Lava Dart's getting close. Underworld Breach is a good draw. Well, Giganta's coming in. Okay, upkeep. I lightning bolt your solitude. Ouch. So now I'm probably on Underworld Breach or Bust. Yep. There's up the beanstalk. I don't know if that's right to Lava Dart the Teferi, but kind of want to turn back on the mutagenic growth. For instance, I could block the solitude and then mutagenic growth in combat. Other plays I could have made would just double Lava Dart the solitude. Don't think I could afford to do nothing. Minamo for double one ring action. Okay, Elish Norn. Just take this last shot at Underworld Breach, I guess. Nope. All right. Pretty close game. So I was a little slow. So I can try Blood Moon as a sideboard strategy. Cinder Vines is fine. And that's going to be it. Mutagenic growth a little weaker against Teferis and lots of removal. Crash Through is not the best. Although I can also board out Abundant Harvest alongside the Blood Moons, because I might lose my access to green mana. Firebolt's one of my weakest cards as well. Well, I'm going to keep the Crash Through. Maybe I'll keep one Mutagenic Growth and go down to 3 Abundant Harvests. I can work with this. Just noticed my opponent has a 65 card deck. I wonder if it was 65 cards in the main or if that number changed after sideboarding. Well, the basic planes doesn't bode well for either my aggression or my Blood Moon plan. Yeah, is this really just Stomping Ground pass? Could Manamorphose try to find something? Which, yeah, I guess I should do that. One reason to hold the Manamorphose is to access green mana post Blood Moon. But I figured just give myself a chance to draw a creature there. Yep. And I've drawn an awful lot of lands. Red, green. Wow, that is an awful lot of lands for an 18 land deck. Okay, so with another land, my opponent can tap 4 to Leyline Binding the Blood Moon. Celestial Purge. Very nice. Okay. Up the beanstalk. You got it. Chalice of the Void, interesting. Well, another try at Blood Moon. Guess I'll just fire the one lava dart while I have a swift spear that's likely to connect in combat. That's pretty good. Now I need some help. I need, I don't know, seek the beast. Chain some Manamorphos. Not Bloodstained Mire. That is exactly what I did not need. Okay, Ottawar of the Blood Moon. Bring to light. Yep. Yeah, bring to light. What's it going to be? Could be Valky. Yep, Valky. It sounds good. Cast Tibalt. Draw another card. It's pretty impressive. Misty Rainforest and Questing Druid exiled to Tibalt. All right, little help here, little help here. Just two lands off the Tibalt, so kind of dodged a bullet, but I need to draw something really, really good before that thing goes ultimate. Chalice 1. So bolt you or bolt Tibalt? How can I win from the Chalice 1 position? I probably just can't. It's like seek the beast into cinder vines and something else. I mean, whatever. I'll just go bolt you in response. Seek the beast into cinder vines plus Underworld Breach. Oh no, I mean, I would even need a Manamorphos to cast the Cinder Vines anyway. Okay, GG. I'll be back for round two. Player subscription, which unlocks all of our CFP Pro content. And I also want to give a thank you to Ultimate Guard for being a longtime supporter of me and my content and my teammates. And of course, thank you for being here. So yeah, what could have helped me in that match? You know, there's sort of two ways you can win against a deck like that. Is you can either do a quick blitz with an unanswered creature, or you can try to steal the game with stuff like Blood Moon. Maybe Boil is a card that I sometimes play in these decks. You could also choose a different color combination, like including blue, so that you have Spell Pierce Mystical Dispute for their One Rings, Omnaths, respectively. But it's tough. I mean, when those four color decks, when they have their mana and they have their removal at the right times, it's just very difficult to beat them. One thing we haven't talked about yet is Underworld Breach, which I think is awesome and gives this deck a whole extra element or a whole extra angle of attack. Is you tended to think of this as like an aggressive burn deck, right, where you're outputting damage really quickly. But if your opponent settles in for the long game, you can get to a spot where you cast Underworld Breach with 12 cards in your graveyard, and that's, you know, that can be a haste creature with a bunch of mutagenic growths. It can be Lightning Bolts. It can be Mishra's Bauble cast five times in the same turn. Underworld Breach can unlock some very cool stuff. Here we have Gigantha against Gigantha. My opponent's on the play and has mulliganed. Bloodstained Mire, all right. So it's not Rakdos Scam because of the Gigantha. We don't know exactly what that Bloodstained Mire means just yet. So let's try to save that with the mutagenic growth. It's a good use of mutagenic growth, is just like kind of countering a burn spell. And I do like that Questing Druid. Okay, I'm just going to get in for two or for one and then seek the beast at the end step, not getting greedy here. This is another thing I should talk about, is seek the beast allows you to play the cards until your next end step. So if you start your turn by casting Seek the Beast on your main phase, then you only have that turn to play the spells. But if you do it during your opponent's turn, you get to untap and have a full turn's worth of mana. Okay, so what am I going to do here? I'm going to respond with Seek the Beast. We are in my opponent's turn three main phase. By the way, they missed the land drop. Stomping Ground, Snow Covered Mountain, doesn't matter. Let's go for the mountain. Revealed a land and a Soul Scar Mage. I'll still use the mutagenic growth to save this thing. Urza's Saga. Okay. So now, could just go Questing Druid into Soul Scar Mage, but then I do not have Delirium. To get Delirium, I would have to actually Surveil into something. It's not that likely because I already have instant sorcery land. Those are kind of the most common types. Bolt the Haywire Might. Yeah, I think maybe I'm just going to pump the brakes and not attack. Play Questing Druid and Soul Scar Mage. So am I up against Jund Saga? That must be it, right? Because they gotta have green mana to pair with the Haywire Might.
He heard that Sharp has green.
Thoughtseize takes away Manamorphos. No problem. Okay. So let's go for Fetch. I think I'll just get another Mountain here. My life total could get a little dicey. Well, I mean, if I have a good turn, my opponent's just going to be dead. So maybe I'm being modest when I say my life total could get dicey. That's probably not going to be the way it plays out. Okay, Abundant Growth. I'm going to Surveil. Then I'm going to name Non-Land. Yeah, the Swift Spear, that is going to be good enough. I guess top's fine there. All right, my opponent is drawing a forest. So let's say I attack, they line up a block against the Questing Druid, I go Bolt You, then it's 3, plus 3 is 6, plus 4 is 10, plus 3 is 13. Alternatively, if I Bolt this, they go to 16 right away. Then they take 3 plus 4 is 7, plus 4 is 11, plus 3 is 14. So I guess it's slightly better to not Bolt the Haywire Mite. Let's just recount. 3 plus 3 is 6, plus 4 is 10, plus 3 is 13. Then they'd gain 2, they'd be at 3. Or I could just resolve damage. They take 8 down to 6, gain 2 up to 8. So basically the Lightning Bolt can be a Lava Axe here, which that is good enough. Moving to sideboard, I like Alpine Moon, I like Blood Moon, probably some number of Ancient Grudge. How many? Two? Two Ancient Grudge? Last match, I cut Mutagenic Growth against the Removal Heavy deck, but this time I think I'm going to keep it because I like it against red-based removal, damage-based removal. So maybe this is a spot where cutting the Abundant Harvest is appropriate. Since I'm bringing in Blood Moon, they become more difficult to cast. I can cut the Baubles. I can trim on Lava Dart, Firebolt, Crash Through type stuff. Kind of like all that, though. How's that? Yep, good hand, good hand. Thank you. I mean, it seems they have a removal spell, but I don't see it. Any way to get to a different play besides turn one Soulscar Mage. Okay, Swift Spear, Bolt the Wren. That all sounds good. Let's see how well this Blood Moon's gonna wind up hitting. Looks like it's going to hit pretty well, though now they're going to get a treasure. Oh, they got my bauble. Brutal. Free value. Well, I'm definitely slamming this Blood Moon. And then I have to choose whether I want to attack with the Swift Spear or leave it back to block Ragavan. I guess I should leave it back. Yeah, Blood Moon just kills the Urza Saga outright, which is quite nice. Ah, the basic forest. We have the Filigree Silex. Sure, it's just like a Engineer Explosives Ratchet Bomb type of effect. Not too scary. Firebolt you. Might as well cash in the mutagenic growth since I'm likely to. That's likely to be my last opportunity since soon the Filigree Silex will threaten to kill Swift Spear. Lava Dart is waiting to hit the Ragavan. We have the Gigantha to think about. Still know about one Verdant Catacombs in my opponent's hand. Yep, take the one. So they're choosing if they want to trade against the Swift Spear, maybe either hold the Silex on one or level it up to get to three. Go for the throat. Yep, that's fine. Yeah. So I guess I have to lava dart that. It stinks because I'm trying to work my way up to Gigantha, but you know, what are you gonna do? My opponent has not pulled for their Gigantha, which is good news for me, because I'm pretty sure if they just played the 5-5, I would lose to it. You know, people ask me about the Gigantha Companion in Modern a lot, and the truth is it doesn't really come up in the games where players have their best draws. When things are going, you know, we'll say normally, you never reach for the Gigantha. But one time when she is really good is when people are kind of stagnating under a Blood Moon, then you're really glad to have Gigantha. No information about my opponent's hand right now. Yes. Yep. Soul Scar Mage down. All right, so zero cards for the opponent, but of course they do have the Gigantha in the companion zone, which is still scary. And there she comes. Okay, do I seek the beast right now or end step? I think it should be end step. I don't think it's good to get greedy right now. Yep. Seven life. I mean, that is achievable. The Gigantha is going to be annoying, but I just got to scrape out seven more damage at some point in this game. I have Firebolt in my graveyard. So I'm a long ways from five mana, but that could come up. Explosives for one. You got it. And they're choosing to just pass with explosives. Sure. Seek the beast. Okay, so I certainly want to play the Mountain from Exile. And then I probably want to just cast the questing druid that is revealed to the Seek the Beast so that I make sure I don't lose access to that. So Mountain, cast this questing druid. Mm-hmm. Now, I could have done Seek the Beast, but any land that I reveal is going to go to waste. Any two-mana spell that I reveal is going to go to waste. And at least this way I have some board presence. I mean, with a little bit of luck, the Questing Druids can just attack into the Gigantha fairly quickly. Yep, there she is. Oh, Lava Dart is one of the best draws I could have had. Because that makes both the Questing Druids 3/3s. 2 damage to the opponent. It's still not appropriate for me to attack. I want to hold back and try to set something up, but Lava Dart is really good on this board. Yep. End of turn, take one. So now, remember I have the Lava Dart in the graveyard, but there's no reason for me to rush this. Like, I'm not in a time crunch because my opponent can't really attack me or progress their own board state unless they have a really good draw. So I can just wait around, play out all my cards. There is a Saga, looks like it could be good, but the Blood Moon just has its number. Oh, man. I have to imagine that's going to be game over, right? Well, let's start casting things. Yeah, I can just double bolt my opponent. It's trivial. All right, so evening the score at 1-1, and I'll be back for round number 3. And welcome back for match number 3. So far I've been on the draw every time, which is not great in Modern. Going first can be a big advantage in a lot of these matchups. My opponent has taken a mulligan, I'll keep. By the way, be sure to check out the Modern Super League, which is a really fun streamer event. It happens starting at 4 p.m. every Wednesday. And you can find it on twitch.tv/anzdmtg. I'll be playing this week if you're watching this video shortly after it comes out. All right, Marsh Flats pass. So I think I'm going to be Mountain Soulscar Mage pass and try to get some bauble value. Raphine's Tower. All right, so probably another one of these Leyline Binding decks. Preordained bottom, Hallowed Fountain tapped. So this is just like a control deck. So now I decide, do I want to just unload damage or do I want to do Seek the Beast as quickly as possible? I think I want to unload damage because the thing with Seek the Beast is they could just counterspell that and it kind of wastes a bunch of time and material. So instead, I'll start by bobbling myself. And if I like the card on top, I can keep it. If not, I can shuffle it away. Do I like a Lava Dart? I'm not sure if I like a Lava Dart. Can probably do better than Lava Dart. Go for red, green. I would like a non-land card, please. And yeah. You know what's awesome about this red prowess deck? All your cards cost 0 or 1 mana. So against somebody who's playing tapped lands, they're trying to work up to like 3 mana to fairies, you can just deploy a lot more threats a lot faster than they can really deal with them. And my opponent is not 1 mana away from Supreme Verdict, so I think I can just play out yet more threats. Yep. That was Godless Shrine untapped. What do I make of that? What would you need 3 mana for at instant speed? Well, why don't I start with Seek the Beast? Copperline Gorge, Underworld Breach. Well, I guess I gotta do the Underworld Breach thing. Geist of St. Traft? Geist of St. Traft entered the revealed zone. Holy cow. All right, well, show me what you can do about 3, 6, 7 attackers. Get the Fatal Push 1. Bowmaster's probably going to block both, although they could choose to keep the Bowmaster's itself around for my Mishra's Baubles draws. So yeah, even if I sack both baubles, I can't cast them again off the breach, so let my opponent draw into that Geist of St. Traft. So interesting, if I use both baubles, they can point both triggers at the Swift Spear. So maybe I want to use one bubble. Maybe I want to use zero. I suspect I want to just still use both. This will be 4-4. Yeah, I'll go for one bauble for right now. They have Watery Grave on top. So two cards in hand. One is Geist of St. Traft. The Ephemerate's coming back again next turn. Here come creatures, lots of creatures. So Watery Grave, Geist of St. Traft, one unknown card. If it's just Geist and tapped land, I feel like I can overpower that. Though these Bowmasters have kind of been a beating against all my Mistress Baubles. That's one thing that's nice about Abundant Harvest is it's a cantrip that doesn't technically draw a card and so gets around Bowmasters, Shouldred, Narset, all that stuff. Okay. Top card is Fatal Push if we get that far. That's good to know about. Lava Dart. So that's basically two +1/+1 counters on all my creatures, which is excellent. Start by Lava Darting the Bowmasters, remove a blocker, and I feel like that's probably pretty close to drawing a concession. Only one card, they can't do a free spell like a Solitude, and whew. I thought that game was going to be a blowout. It turned out being a bit closer. Turned out to be a bit closer than expected, but still was able to get over the finish line. I guess it looks like another matchup for Blood Moon. Why not? And then any other additions? You know, like I would expect this player to have Leyline Binding, but not necessarily. They could just be playing like an old school Esper colored deck. Kozilek's Return. If I don't imagine they're keeping in Geist of St. Traft after sideboarding, but if they do, Kozilek's Return kills that. Can also be okay against Bowmasters. I don't love Mutagenic Growth in this type of matchup. So I'd say we have the optionals up here. This is 14 cards. I get to choose 9 of them to be in my deck. Yeah, I'm in for the crash through. No to Kozilek's Return. No to the Mutagenics. Here we go. Still don't know exactly what my opponent's up to over there. I mean, we saw a lot of the classics that you'd expect from a blue and black deck, like Fatal Push, Bowmasters, Preordain. I guess they definitely had some Ephemerate stuff going on, so maybe have the Pitch Elementals. My hand is fine. It's once again the fourth land is a little bit redundant, but kind of like a good six card hand here. Oh boy. Guess we're on fetch a tapped stomping grounds. I lost my whole hand. I have zero spells to work with. Somehow Ephemerate on grief is even more brutal than not dead after all. Wow. Okay, so that Kozilek's Return's gotta come in then. I mean, I think I can almost just pack it in right now. I guess I could technically get a questing druid large enough to block the sanctifier. I'm gonna bolt the grief just because that thing's gonna kill me much too fast. Wow, can you imagine if I had the Kozilek's Return? Non-land, please. Boy, I don't even really want to cast the Crash Through against the Bowmasters, but I don't have much choice. So I'm going to take one down to seven. I'm going to play my land, pass. If they attack me with everything, I can block the Orc army, fetch down to six, use Seek the Beast, survive at one, and then maybe there's some combinations of cards that I can string together a win. Preordain one top, one bottom. I'm sure I can't win if they've drawn anything relevant. Seek the Beast. Underworld Breach, ineffective against the Sanctifiers. GG. Okay, so Kozilek's Return in. Underworld Breach is out. One mutagenic growth, one breach. What do I want in that spot? I guess one mutagenic. All right, game three. No. This five lander is just not good enough, and it doesn't play well against grief and a mulligan. That's better. The Kozlek's Return is like, you want that to be the sixth card down in your library, or, you know, the 13th card down in your library. If it's in the opening hand, it might be awkward. They get to see it with grief, all that type of stuff. But I'm going to keep, and I'm going to bottom, I guess, an extra land. Stomping Ground. Hooray, I didn't lose my whole hand. I probably should have fetched at some earlier point, because now if they just go land pass and I fetch in my end step, they can Bowmasters the Dragon's Rage Channeler. And I just don't get any surveil value. So yeah, a little bit of a miss sequencing for me. Seek the Beast. I did hit Blood Moon. So a third land, Blood Moon. Hopefully that keeps any pesky Sanctifier Envex at bay. It does make it more tricky for me to cast my own Questing Druid. I can now only do that if either the Blood Moon gets removed or I draw Metamorphos. But wow, Basic Island, that is a little bit annoying. And then I drew a green card. It's partly my deck building and sideboarding to blame. But okay, land and Soulscar Mage. I could pull for Giganta too, which I think is probably a good move. Sauron's Ransom. Okay, face up pile, face down pile. The face up. So I'm going to put the Sauron's Ransom in by itself in the face up pile. And then the three white cards in the face down. And they took the three white cards, so we are really hoping that they never get to cast those. All right, well, Blood Moon is not very effective this game. Well, I stand corrected. The Blood Moon is actually very effective against me. It's stopping me from playing my green cards. I guess I'll just do nothing for now. And then probably now, like, end of turn, I'll try to kill off everything with the Kozilek's Return, unlock the Bauble and the Crash Through. Yeah, so Ephemerate should not save anything in this particular case. They can just Ephemerate for one damage if they want to do that. Okay, another Ephemerate is the top card. Gigantha as mana fixing under the Blood Moon. Yeah. Well, I guess this is the life of a Blood Moon player. It's just a very volatile card, and sometimes you're going to base your game plan around it, and it's going to do not much at all for you. Yeah, it's just going to be too hard to fight through these Ephemerates with my spot removal spells. GG. Hey, welcome back to match number 4 of Modern Red Prowess. I'm off to a rocky 1-2 start, but trying to even the score here. I'm against a Kahira Companion. I'll keep my hand. So Hollow Fountain at least means no Renin 6 in my future, so I can go ahead and play the 1-1 Channeler. So tempting to want to start surveilling to hit land drops. Think it might be right to just cast another creature, but let's start with an attack and see what happens. What are you up to over there? Hey. And step dress down. No problem. All right, so here's Narset. This looks like a spot where I can maybe upkeep Bolt the Narset, try to surveil into second land. Good surveil. That's a good surveil. And we've done it. How concerned am I about Supreme Verdict? I guess Supreme Verdict is something that could be out there. Firebolt the Narset, see if I get Delirium. Save the Swift Spear for a future turn. Zagoth Triome reduces the cost of Leyline Binding down to 2 mana, and there's Leyline Binding. Swift Spear. Bauble. Interesting, questing druid. So I'm gonna get Delirium. It's gonna be a 5, 6, 7. I think I'm just gonna bin this. The goal here is to set up for some Underworld Breach turns. So they Lorien revealed, that means they're not drawing that Steam Vents. Okay, Narset round two. Finds Leyline Binding for next turn. So here comes Underworld Breach play number one. Do I play the Copperline Gorge or do I want another card in the graveyard? Right now I have 11 in the graveyard. So I play this minus three to bolt you. Then I play the Bauble a few more times. That's Swift Spear is going to be one, two, three, four, five. Just play the Bauble once. Okay, so I think this is gonna check out, assuming they do not have Solitude, which they of course could have Solitude. Right, they just conceded. I guess there's no Solitude. So once again, to recap that, it was going to be play Mishra's Bauble like two or three times, bolt you're down to six, lava dart you, those not from the Underworld Breach, just from the flashback. So I was going to be dealing five direct damage to my opponent and then attacking with like a, six or seven or eight power Swift Spear. And yeah, it doesn't take a lot of mana for Underworld Breach to be pretty deadly in this deck. So now what? Have Cindervine's option. We have Blood Moon option. I guess that's probably about it. Do I believe my opponent's going to leave in a bunch of Narsets? I don't think I believe that. But I think trimming Mutagenic Growth is probably the first order of business. This is a great hand. Leyline of Sanctity. So that's mostly stopping burn spells. It's not that big of a deal. It's fine. But that's the difference between Red Prowess and the actual burn deck is this deck's much more about getting damage in with your creatures. And if I really want it, I do have Cindervines for the ley line. Kind of like passing with Seek the Beast here. I don't know if I really want to play into a counter spell. I could play into a counter spell. But no, I like this plan. Pass with Seek the Beast. So one thing that's cool is I can actually cast this in my own end step if my goal is to play around a counterspell, which that does seem like it's going to be good here. Because you have until your next end step. Got Metamorphose, Abundant Harvest. Well, that's one reason to not wait. I did not necessarily expect a burn spell out of this deck. Okay. So how about Channeler into Metamorphose Harvest? Not expecting the Metamorphose to get countered. They could, in theory, have Spell Pierce or Force of Negation, but I just don't think those cards would really be in the deck after sideboarding. So here comes Channeler. Yeah, that's fine to go to the graveyard. Red, green. Crash Through can go to the graveyard. Take non-land. Play my Soul Scar Mage. That'll be that. So there, my opponent Lorien revealed for Hallowed Fountain, but they did not play that. They played an untapped land. So they're kind of representing a Leyline Binding or something. Wow, just straight up Lightning Bolt. Okay. I guess. So I guess it's going to be Abundant Harvest for a land and then Blood Moon. And then just gotta hope that the Blood Moon hurts them more than it hurts me. Cut off from white mana for now. Here's the Kahira in hand. So can't burn players, but I can still burn planeswalkers. I kind of like just playing the second Blood Moon just to make sure. Could main phase Seek the Beast. Could pull for Gigantha. Yeah, I'll go for main phase. Hit two lands. Remember, I'm not casting those questing druids until such time as I draw Metamorphose or my opponent removes the Blood Moons. Okay. Subtlety on the Gigantha. It's fine. I'll put it on top. I can't even Can't even bobble my opponent. Oh, but there's Metamorphose. Very nice. That can unlock any combination of Cinder Vines and Questing Druid that I see fit. Okay, I feel like this is the first game where Blood Moon really did its Blood Moon thing. All right, so 2-2, and don't go anywhere for the fifth and final match. I'll be right back. Hello, welcome back to the fifth and final match of today's video. I'm trying to put up a positive record, and I'm paired against Modern End Boss, the famous streamer Doomwake. Well, you viewers can fact check me on these, but I believe I've achieved the dubious honor of losing all five die rolls in this league. My hand is fine. It gets a lot worse if the Soul Scar Mage is killed, but go ahead and keep this. So I did lose my die rolls, but my opponents have out-mulliganed me a lot. So, for example, Doomwake is starting with five cards this game. Okay, here goes nothing. Yep. Well, at least it's a matchup where the Soul Scar Mage is likely to survive. So probably on my turn, Abundant Harvest for a land, Firebolt you, get in for five. Four mana in the mana pool, Simic Growth Chamber in hand. What else do we have here? Karn the Great Creator, holy cow. Chalice of the Void, wow, okay. Well, this is definitely happening. Guessing the Grazer is going to block no matter what. But I'm going to go for attack player. So Mutagenic Growth gets us up to 5. Bolt would be 9 damage. Double Lava Dart would be also 9 damage. Just going to go Bolt Karn. Remember, I'm expecting to lose access to all these cards next turn. So just cash in as many of my one mana plays as I can. Okay, so Stirrings finds the one ring. I do not think this is going to go well for me. I think the combination of one ring plus chalice plus lots of mana is probably enough for me to scoop. Cool. See the draw step. Call it a game. Cindervines, Blood Moon, Alpine Moon, Ancient Grudge. And out comes the slow stuff, which could be some number of questing druids. Could be Underworld Breach, Bauble, Crash Through, Firebolt. I could see trimming the fourth Lava Dart, though Lava Dart's usually pretty good. I think Mutagenic Growth is fine just for the goldfish value. Something like this. Ugh, this hand. I think I want to just be faster. I mean, you saw me during sideboarding. I was like, what are my slowest cards? Questing Druid, Underworld Breach. I left in two copies of Druid, one of Underworld Breach. The lack of a one-drop creature here, I think, is just a deal breaker. And this is, yeah, this is better. So we're going to go land, Channeler. Then I want to have Abundant Harvest for land, play second Channeler. What do I want to have left in the chamber? Probably bottom Mutagenic Growth. Forest Grazer. What the heck? I guess the Cascading Cataracts is to go with Golos off of the Karn. Sure. Land, please. And two lightning bolts, trying to hit third land for Blood Moon and or get Delirium. this bad feeling about engineered explosives in this game. Amulet of Vigor. Amulet of Vigor. Yikes. Wow, is this a turn two Titan? I mean, turn two anything. Turn two nine mana. Well, that was, functionally similar to Engineered Explosives, except it was a lot flashier. I mean, I guess I'm still playing the Blood Moon, right? I can't let my opponent have both the mana and the Karn, so it's... You know, if you could promise me I had Lightning Bolt in my top two cards, then maybe you could sell me on Seek the Beast, but I just lose immediately if my opponent untaps with, what would it be, 10, 14 mana plus Karn, something like that. Guess they can get Haywire Might now. Okay, well, at least it's just the Gruul Turf in hand. So, I mean, that can represent Gigantha, but no other payoff just yet. It's actually pretty good. Just kill the Urza Saga, neutralize the mana a little bit. Swift Spear, Soul Scar Mage. So now what can you get off the Karn with access to, you know, three or four mana? Is there a second Haywire Might? Hand has Gigantha and two freshly drawn cards. Engineered Explosives would work with the Karn, though if you blow that for one, you destroy all of your amulets. Cashing in Karn, what will it be? Door to Nothingness? What? Not sure I get it. I mean, I guess you can use Giganta to try to power that. Who knows? Or a Boseiju on the Blood Moon. Okay, so they actually did have Boseiju, but they're choosing to use it on Timeless Lotus. Oh boy. This is a first for me. I have not been defeated in this way before. Timeless Lotus adding 15 mana and Door to Nothingness. That's not how I thought this league would end, but man, that's pretty cool. All right, so gonna have to settle for 2 and 3 with Red Green Prowess this time around. Remember to keep your eye on the YouTube channel for more Modern content, and yeah, check out that Modern Super League if you have some time free on Wednesday. I'll see you next time.